Instructional Designers in Offices Drinking Coffee is brought to you by dominKnow, makers of dominKnow One, the all-in-one cloud-based e-learning authoring tool for teams. You can learn more at dominKnow.com. That's dominKnow.com. Now, here's this week's episode.
There's the theme song. Everybody got a little dance in the chair going on?
Yeah, we do. And I don't care what the topic is for today, do not leave this room, everybody.
Yes, you cannot escape.
You're in for the long haul.
Everybody's clued in today. Awesome.
Looks like we got weather checks coming in from all over.
Yeah. It's an average fall day here in Eastern Ontario. Oh my God, what just happened? Transformation.
I didn't practice my reveal.
I know. We didn't go that route yet, so. Yeah. We didn't talk about that in the green room when you donned the dancing wig. Yeah. Folks, we have a really awesome session planned today here. Before we jump into that, though, we've often have to focus in our e-learning on cognitive load. But I didn't realize until our guest joined us with the wig and the mustache that we also have to take into account incognito load as part of our planning. I worked so hard on that pun. Come on, you got to give it to me at least. Okay.
I know. We could use right. That title anyways.
we needed to set it up first. We needed to prime the audience by talking about cognitive load.
Right. And then we could have had the reveal then. Oh, man. We missed such an opportunity to set up such a really bad dad joke. That was really...
We are not joke writers.
Do you guys know clearly. The Jackson 5 had... cognitive load, right? It was Jermaine. How you get dad jokes?
Do you know what? I guess for you, dad jokes are as easy as ABC 1, 2, 3.
I got three kids.
How do there you we know? Go. Hey. All righty. We've already jumped into some chit-chat here, but we better make sure that folks know who you are. We have our awesome guest, Alex Salas, with us here. He's joining us again. He's been with us before. But for those folks who haven't met you with us previously, Alex, give us a little bio, a little introduction to yourself.
Well, it all started when I was 3. I was walking on the beach once. Guys, so thank you for having me here. It's a pleasure. If you don't know me yet, I'd like to say that, right? Like I'm famous. If you don't know me yet. By the way, if you don't know me yet. So I started as a learning professional about 12, 13, 14 years ago. And then I've been doing crazy stuff with instructional design for about 8 years, creative things. And I worked in Fortune 100 companies. And I am the owner of StyleLearn, who is the owner of eLearning Launch, which is the academy for the eLearning designers. And if you hang out on LinkedIn, you probably see my posts. So pleasure to be here.
Very cool. And we were making some bad jokes. I thought they were good jokes. Like that's anything new with us.
Yeah, they're not bad.
I'm self-conscious actually about my own ability to make bad puns. I shouldn't be. I've got a lifetime of
experience.
You learn from your mistakes, and I've made a lot of really bad puns in the past. So, and that doesn't seem to thwart me from moving forward ever again. But we were making some puns earlier about escape rooms, and that's our topic today is the idea of using an escape room as a framework for an e-learning project. Maybe we'll just start with what brought you to this idea. Let's talk about the escape room origin story here.
Oh yeah. So, well, first of all, I played it. I went to a real, one of those pre-pandemic stories. I played it. I thought it was interesting. And from there, I was like, I wonder how we can do this, how we can tap into it. And kind of the, because usually when you go to escape rooms, it's a team building thing. It's that. But sometimes when you go, it's like, you know, yeah, there's a story in there. You get all like, oh, somebody was killed here and something happened and blah, blah, blah. But then the problems, you know, tend to be really disconnected to things and puzzles and stuff. And you're like, and I'm not a math guy. So, you know, sometimes I'm just out. Overall, fun. It was engaging. And so then the inquisitive thought was there. It's like, I've been talking about gamification for a long time. And this is just one of those avenues, right? To do some game design. And actually, I believe more in game design in learning than rather saying gamification, because a lot of people hear gamification and they think, oh, points, badges. And so that was the main inspiration. So then I found, you know, I think two things about this for people, right? So like, there's the experience you can create for people, but also I think from the creative perspective, from the design perspective, it's challenging and it's super fun.
Yeah. Neato. I mean, so, some of the things that you know, that are typical of an escape room. There are. Like you said, there's a story, you know, somebody was murdered or there was something that, you know, needs to be a puzzle that needs to be solved.
Right.
And then there are clues that are usually presented in like small increments through different, you know, smaller puzzles and smaller challenges. Any other kind of major, I don't know, tropes or important factors of an escape room that we need to think about beyond those?
Oh, yeah, man. We're going to, you know, we should just stop talking about it. Let's go play.
So all right.
There's a link in the chat. And this is to a G drive, and in there you can just grab whatever is in there and have fun. But what I want you to do is actually go grab one of the escape room files that say, and let me know if you can't get it. We'll figure it out. You know, we have some limitations here in this tool, right? So we can do another link somewhere else. But one thing is, we're gonna play. We'll do a little play, and if you're all learning folks in here, you may find this interesting. So is escape. I want you to find the one that says escape room, no software. So escape room, no software, not the underscore B, but the escape room, no software. And I'm going to go ahead and share my screen real quick. Is that cool with you guys?
Yeah, do it.
All right. Yep. Let's dooby dooby doo. Dooby dooby doo. Where are you at?
Yeah, it's all like, the thing that I've always found interesting is that one of the most powerful things that I've always thought about escape rooms is you mentioned the term earlier, Alex, the escape, the teamwork part of it, right? It's normally like a team building type event and
that
whatnot.
Is,
and I often
correct.
Wonder if you still get the same effect going through one by yourself, whether it's virtual or not. And if what we really have to think about as instructional designers is more about how do we make these types of experiences virtually a team style event, because it is the few times that I've done escape rooms myself, it was the whole fun of it was interacting with the other people that were doing it with you, the panic, the excitement when you get one of the clues, all that kind of stuff, and you know, that kind of thing. So
yes, you're completely right. You're right on point. So what I did on this one that you're seeing here is called, it was built for, I did it for Monica Cornetti, who's doing something on gamification and stuff like that. And I was like, okay, the audience that I'm going to be dealing with, they're not going to be e-learning developers. So I'm not going to be coming in with anything that has an e-learning tool on it. So we built something that was just on the PDF to show an example, get people playing. And we did it over VILT. So what we did is we used Zoom and we did breakout rooms.
Cool.
So this is an idea, right? So we did breakout rooms, and those breakout rooms pretty much were the escape rooms for each person. And now until they solve the problem, they couldn't come out of the escape room, the breakout room. So that was the idea behind it. But the framework here, I mean, you're right on point. We were talking about these things, right? So Christopher was saying, hey, you know, there's a story, there's a backstory that happens. You were talking about teamwork and stuff like that. So this is this file that is the escape room, no software, is one of set of challenges. And the main thing about it is to present it with a backstory. So start with somewhat of a story to engage people on, right? And it's sort of the experience. If anybody has played a game, then you have that, right? So here you have a backstory. There's a party. People are hanging out, this and that. And the host decides that they're going to, you know, he's going to change. In the middle of the night, he's going to change what's happening, right? So, hey, I got a game going on. Let's go. Follow me. Takes people over to the library, right? And yeah, I keep scrolling in the wrong place. So, oh, Acrobat has an internal error. Oh, well, that's nice. Oh, that never happens.
Thanks, Acrobat.
Yeah, thank you, Acrobat. You're so awesome. Who's using Adobe products? Let me go over to yeah. No hate. Just saying. I'm gonna go over to. Hey, I'm gonna like you guys. I'm gonna go to Google Drive. How's that? Fun. All right. So.
Or maybe this is the first puzzle for you to solve in our escape room today.
Can you solve that, Alex? I was like, yeah, nah, listen, the older I get, the less I want to solve stuff. So, so all right. So in the second part, we have, you know, you get to the library. And in the library, you know, you set this up. So the way I built this, by the way, just so everybody knows, so you're thinking, oh, man, I can't do this. This is a lot of stuff or whatever. This is all Photoshop and PowerPoint. So I grabbed the stock character. This character is a stock image out of, you know, one of the stock libraries.
I was hoping you were going to say you shot this. He's your neighbor and he's a character, cool guy. And you went.
Yeah, man. Yeah, absolutely. What are you hearing? Yeah. So, no, I found this guy in the street, gave him clothes.
There we go.
Anyway,
here, put this on.
You want a story? I'll give you a story. So, you know, you get to the library. He brings everybody into the library. He goes, hey, what's up, guys? Got a cool idea. This and that. We're going to play a little game. Each challenge. So this is sort of like the introduction to what's going to happen, how you're going to play. But notice that, you know, we're not saying up front, hey, welcome to escape room. You're going to escape. All right. So that's the whole purpose here. And this is for the situation of being on a group activity, especially over VILT. So in that sense, we're just getting people, okay, what's going on here? We're going to play a game. All right, cool. So he's saying, hey, no problem. And I'll be right back. And you notice that the face got a little bit different here, right? Like, yeah, don't worry. I'll be right back. And so,
mustache.
Or will I? Right? So anyway, so now you know, we want to test if people are paying attention to things, but it's a trap. Burris has locked the door to the library. Now what? And now we got the first challenge. So he's coming back from some kind of window or something. Hey, relax. It's all cool. You're going to have this amount of minutes, and you're going to have to figure out, let's find out if you guys are really lifelong learners. Let's solve these challenges and see if you can get the key, which is in the safe. So this is sort of like the setup. Your setup, with regardless of where you're doing this, right? So if you're doing it, I mean, you could do this face-to-face, or you can do this VILT, or you could do this e-learning. It's the same thing. You're going to have a room. You're going to have a context by which you get the person in the room. And then in that context, you're going to place these different objects, hidden things, trap doors and stuff like that. But the whole purpose of this is that you're not delivering content up front, right? So like, you know, what's the other option you have? You have a course. So, hey, welcome to the course. Here are the learning objectives. You know the definition of customer service, you know, so you start going with all that stuff. Why just not getting to a story? Get them in here and going, all right, so you're going to have to figure out some of these clues, some of these riddles, some of these puzzles. And from then on, find, and that will lead to a next thing. So you can have several challenges within a room, or you can just have several rooms that provide just small challenges. So in this situation, we're going to have the first challenge here, and it's what happens on that book. You found the book and the book says the world needs all of it and its antonym is equal of equal length. So what is something that the world needs all of it? And it's
love.
Antonym.
Oh, love.
Love. All right. Make a note. Make a note. Somebody put in the chat the number of letters for love. All right. All right. Then we got the couch. And the couch says, with this law, that which is enjoyed will be repeated. What law is this? That which is enjoyed will be repeated. Ah, it's got a little harder now, right?
We need anybody to chat.
Anybody Googling yet? Anybody chatting? Anybody Googling you? Come on. See, this is what you got to think. Like, yeah,
this is where we actually have to confess to our audience. Brent and I are always pretty much clueless. So we need help from the chat there.
So please, yes.
In the chat.
Help us out here, folks.
All right. So J-Rock says, hey, what's up, J-Rock? Says, law of children's streaming programming. Law of attraction. That's close. That's close. Law of repetition, says Shaza. Shaza, really? Who came up with that law? I know Shaza, though, so don't guys think I'm picking on her. I know her. So she's an e-launcher, by the way. So thermodynamics. Okay, cool. All right. Wait. Hold on, Donna. Let me pick on this. So you're saying thermodynamics. So that which is enjoyed will be repeated. So I guess if I put a heat pad on my back and I feel good, I'm going to do it again. Nah, that's good. I like it. Law of trees. All right. Awesome. Are the answers within the room or do they require outside knowledge? The answers are for you to find. There is a riddle. There is a clue.
It's under the couch cushion.
What would that be? Yeah, it was under the couch cushion. You found this note. And it says, with this law. J-Rock says, law of diminishing returns. All right. So you want me to give you a clue?
Yeah, you better.
If I give you a clue, so. I'm going to drop 2 minutes from this. That's a penalty, right? So, okay. It's getting close. Shaz is giving us clues.
Ooh.
It is something from Thorndike.
Oh, what
you guys know who Thorndike is?
What's a good instructional design law?
Ooh. Yeah. Law of effect. There we are.
Ooh, nice, Janice. Ding ding ding. Winner winner.
Ding ding. Janice is helping us getting out of this room. Thank you, Janice. Thank you. So divide it by two and use it twice. So what number is that? Two. Where are the math wizards here? Effect divided by two. Use it twice. Oh no. All right, you'll figure it out. We'll figure it out when we get there. All right, next challenge. Okay, we'll see those. I'm not seeing the numbers yet, but we'll see them at the end. So the note is
42.
Chris got it. Chris got it. 3-3. Chris got it. All right, Chris. Winning, Chris. The one who makes it does not need it. The one who buys it has no use for it. The user can't see or feel it. It's not a good place to live. It's not a good place to live. What could that be? Just think about it. The one that makes it doesn't need it. A coffin. Ooh, yes. Great. So how many letters in that? So this guy is surprised. You guys made it to the end. What's the number? How do we open the safe?
33. And then what was the other number?
4336. Chris with the clutch. All right. You got it. You got the key. You're getting out. Good job, people. Good introduction. Thank you. It's great. We made it. All right. Ooh, you got out. That's awesome. All right. So quick examples here, right? Quick things of how you can set something up. Now let's talk about You guys want to do another one, or you want me to just talk about rules?
Let's talk about it for a second.
All
right. Yeah. All right. Let's talk about it.
So
actually, I might have made a mistake when I switched to, drive. So my bad. But I was using the B sample.
Okay.
Because of the whole Acrobat thing. So my bad. All right. So Burr's wearing a Rocco. Nice J-Rock. All right. So here we go. So let's talk about it. What are some of the thoughts here?
Well, you've already talked, visually how you created it using pretty common tools and stock art and that sort of a thing from that visual perspective. I will say I like the choice of fonts, which you start out with that kind of comic book framing at the beginning, so that even though we're later into something that looks more realistic than a comic book kind of approach, the room itself using fairly realistic looking photos, you still got that connection to a kind of a comic book story going through.
Right.
And yeah. I think somebody mentioned too, and I totally agree. I think that the writing and the actual design of it and the content itself, like all things, right, is really the most critical part. But the visuals, like if with really good, well done art, it does add a certain value to it. And I think people get drawn to it. And I think people do engage differently when they are, when they see something to kind of help the story along a little bit, right? I think that visual element really, it's not just an added clicky clicky bling bling sort of, hey, it's fancy sort of thing. I really do think cognitively getting people to engage and to think about the answers and to be curious and to kind of open up that part of your mind that helps you be get you in problem solving mode and be a little bit more creative, I think is super valuable. And I probably wouldn't have said that if I hadn't have hung out with Kevin Thorne and Carl Kopp and learned about how to unleash that sort of thinking, that locked business brain that you have, and to unlock it is so important.
Right. So I know Kevin and Carl do the escape. They do their, it's like escape away or step away.
Step away. Yep.
Yeah, step away workshop. They usually do it around this time, and they were doing it over here by my neighborhood in Orlando.
It's virtual now.
Now it's virtual, yeah. But Kevin is really big on graphic novels, and I'm behind him on that. And obviously, Carl is the reason why I got into gamification to begin with when I saw him. So yeah, the whole purpose here is that engagement is sort of like framing everything from the beginning of, it's the difference between saying together, like, we are all learning people. And so if I say, hey, let's learn, everybody was going to be like, yeah, wow, let's get into it, right? But if for the rest of the world, right, for the rest of the people that are not like us, then if we say let's learn, that may not really be like, but if you say let's play, then that might be a little different, right? There's a different association. Yep. So I would really, so here's the thing. The second one, the first one that I showed you, which is supposed to be the second one, that one had like general different knowledge are here. This one, the original, has directly three challenges that are directly involved with instructional design theory knowledge or anything like that. So you guys want to test each other on that one?
Sure, let's do it. Yeah.
All right, let's rock it. And thank you everybody for playing. Awesome engagement on the chat. Appreciate that. And let's roll out to the, what was supposed to be the first one.
Yeah, but before we jump into that, Paul asks a good question. And this was one of the ones I was thinking of yesterday.
Oh, we do have questions. Great.
About the types of content that would probably fit best into an escape room. Maybe you kind of, while we're going through this next one, we can think about that, and then everybody can kind of drop some answers in.
Yeah. definitely something that I have some thoughts about it, and we'll touch on it for sure. I did see a question by J-Rock. It says, it seems like escape room clues are heavily dependent on prior knowledge. So does that mean that the ER work as assessments? Yeah, they could work as assessments. That's one way to do it, J-Rock. Other thing I will say is that, yeah, you in this example, you know, it's only about what, four different things. I'm not giving you a lot of stuff to look at, but you can have the content peppered throughout as clues in the room and use that as the motive to roll out. So right now in this one, yeah, in this example that I'm showing you, all you're seeing is just a riddle that takes you to go find out things. But if you think about it, the whole idea here, since this one's were kind of built for VILT type settings, online stuff like we're doing right here, is to not limit people to anything, right? So how many of you thought about Googling stuff? Go ahead and drop it in the chat. Because ideally, that's what, if you didn't know anything about it, you should be kind of like Googling about the clue. Mm-hmm. And doing that will lead you to find something that perhaps you didn't know anything about. Mm-hmm. So let's go there. So same story as before, nothing different. Clues are different, right? So here's the clues. And at this time, I am not going to say anything. You guys are going to have to figure out what this is.
All right, chatters.
Here we go, chats.
Get into it.
Yeah.
Paying attention, inform, stimulate, recall, present content, provide guidance, elicit performance, provide feedback, assess performance. All of that found under the cushions of a couch. Yeah. And so while folks are out there doing their thing and throwing stuff into the chat, like, I mean, a couple of other thoughts that I had, the limited sort of scope of this, the few, only a handful of clues, et cetera, really makes it, I think, suitable for the context of it being part of a breakout room. You don't want people gone for a half an hour or an hour, you know, boom, they're going to fade away. But this is enough to, the shortness actually, you know, actually works for keeping the, you know, the engagement, the interest. And we've talked, you know, some folks have been talking about presenting information and assessment, but it's also just a great way to introduce something. So you could, you know, use these small things and then actually move into the fuller content, you know, after that with a sense of, you know, funness or what have you. So lots of things going on in the chat. And Gagne seems to be a common theme. Nine.
Right. So what about it? Okay, Sarah, I think Sarah's onto something.
Yeah, we are missing one.
All right, we're missing one. Okay, good points. Make notes. We'll see.
The only part of Gagne that I ever use in presentations in talking about and that I ever memorized was gaining attention. That's pretty much the only time I ever bring up Gagne is how even he thought the most important thing, the number one thing of all the nine events is you got to get their attention. And if you talk to the neuroscientists, they'll agree too.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember, nuns used to get my attention.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't all mean right. The learning's going to actually stick or anything, but you got to start somewhere, and that's an excellent spot.
All right, so what about this one? You can't go forward, and Addy is not. Teachers can do it, but learners would not. Grant and Jay just like to play. Blum, blum. Blum, blum. Blum, blum.
Silence in the room while everybody madly types.
Any ideas? Are we rocking people's minds today? What's going on?
Yeah, the chat got suddenly quiet, eh? Like,
I know. Everyone's thinking. Everyone's it's Googling. Like,
what is
this? Yeah.
Can go forward, and Addy is not. What is Addy?
Learning.
I don't know. What is it?
Teaching. No, instructing. Instruction.
Yeah. Addy's not a model, says J-Rock. Hey, you're right about that.
Ooh, maybe. There you go.
Sam. Hey, does Sam go forward?
Excuse Gamification.
All right. Addy is analysis. Okay. But remember, Addy is not. And Addy is not. Sam goes forward. So it can't be Sam. So what can it be? And when you say Sam, do you mean Skinner's Sam or Sam Allen's Sam?
Sam as in the framework, I think.
Michael Allen's Sam.
Yeah.
Well, actually, it was the original is Skinner's model, Sam.
Ah.
But that's a whole different context. All right. So
yes, indeed.
All right, Piaget's theory. I haven't kind of forgotten. All right, going from there. Okay. Any teachers in the house? I can't believe teachers are not picking this up. Shazza.
I'm sure there's plenty of teachers.
Come on, Shazza. Come on, Shazza. All right, so let's think about that one. I'll bring you back. You can't go forward. Addy is not. Teachers can do it, but learners will not. Grant and Jay just like to play. Any reason why those two words may be, I don't know, with increased focus on them? Think about it. Just letting you know. Last one.
Okay.
I taught pigeons to bowl. I taught pigeons to bowl. People here were shocked like there were rats. My first name in numbers is? We definitely took it up here, huh?
Yeah, who is the Skinner? No. Who's the guy?
Anybody, anybody Googling anything? I just want to know. Anybody Googling stuff? You granted, Jay Leno.
I'm afraid that if I start Googling, I'm going to mess up all my screens.
Understand it by design.
So yeah.
All right.
As
so
the
first
guy
of all,
doing the show, I can't do
going
this.
Going back to the previous one, Mary and Shazza, you got it right. It is backwards design. So backwards design. Good. And Laurie, backwards design. Good. Yes, it's backwards design. And okay, so PG saying Grant Wiggins and Jay McTigg. Who are those folks? Those were the teachers that in the 90s developed backwards design. You guys heard of backwards design, right?
I've never heard it called that, but I always was taught from the very beginning to do it, design with the end in mind and work your way back. Start
yeah,
with the assessment, build.
Well, the theory behind that, just theory, I'm not trying to, you know, steer anything, but I think that Franklin Covey kind of appropriated a little bit of that concept and made it commercial. So that's where you get the beginning with the end in mind. If you go back to the Franklin Covey. All right, good. So we got backwards design. We have the two words. You got the two names. And we got Paul with the clutch on the last one.
Ooh, he must have Googled.
Burris. That's the first name of Skinner. And you were right, Brent. And if you pay attention to the story, there it is.
Oh,
the guy's name is Burris. He has a backstory and an agenda. He thinks that people don't really know learning design, and he wants to know that people really remember this stuff. So anyway, that's his vengeance. So what numbers do we come up with?
So Burris, wow. Okay, quick, get your phone pad out.
So on the first one, let's go back square. So the first one, we know that we have one missing.
This one's right? Harder than the other one.
It is. It is. I was going to take you. Yeah, I was going to take you deep first and then make it easy.
Okay.
People, usually what I love to see on the first one is to get the reactions, right? So people would have been in that room. Like on the first time we did it in the breakout room. First of all, there were people that didn't ever seen and never known or heard of escape room, right? So they're like, I didn't know what I was doing, blah, 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 blah. But guess what? There was people in the room that helped them out. Oh, yeah, I did escape room for. I know what this is. We need to find clues. We need to. So now we got informal learning and social stuff happening, right? So then that's what that was the purpose there. But, you know, technical difficulties took us to where we need to go. So there we are. All right. So, hey, so Paul says he didn't go. He saw his name in the PDF.
Mm-hmm.
There you go, man. Paul is just rocking it. All right, so we had 9, I'm guessing. what do we get out of this one? What numbers we get?
Now that one, I don't know. Who got numbers for number to the second one?
We need 4 digits, right? So first number is 9. Yeah, Sarah, you're right. All right. All right. 9 inherent retention and transfer. All right.
5, 3, 7.
He says 5. 3. Sarah wins.
I think that's a different guy, J-Rock.
Sarah wins. Sarah has won. Sarah, you get... Well, I don't know.
Oh,
Sarah was asking
name.
A question, gotcha. So Sarah doesn't win anything. No. I'm kidding. So Sarah, how do you get it? Figure it out. Let us know. Tell us your clue here. Yeah! First verse, Dale. So Sarah, how do you figure it out? There we go.
Okay.
Remember how I said, like, you know, I wonder why these things are in bold.
Very cool.
Nice.
I will say, so let's, I mean, not to, we're getting kind of close to wanting to wrap this up, but I'm thinking to myself, what are possibly, let's play devil's advocate here, what are some of the negative things that could either backfire or go wrong, or just why an escape room might just be a bad idea?
All right. So let me break you off on that, because we got another document here, and it's called the rules. So the rules for doing this, and you guys can keep that. That's for you to get the guidance on. So I figured this would be a good guidance for you to follow, so you can figure out what it is. Besides, and we're going to talk about content as well. But first of all, no gimmicks, right? So don't get into, hey, there's a game. You're going to play. It's an escape room. Huh? Can you escape? You know, that type of stuff, right? So don't get into gimmicks. It needs to be not about the escape room itself, but it needs to be about that ultimate learning goal. So you're still going to need to have some instructional design done, all right? You need to have some kind of good elaborated course or whatever you're going to do to achieve whatever it is you need to achieve. Question that we have from Carolina says, when doing this in Zoom, was there a moderator in each break room or the participants followed by a host? I assisted the folks in the break room, where they were able to call me, you know, on Zoom, they can call you up and say, hey, we need help. And so I stepped in there and I just listened to what they had to say, but I didn't really give them answers to things.
Gotcha.
Okay. So yeah, great question. Absolutely. That's what you want to do. You don't want to, so it's in breakout rooms. You don't want to send people out there and be like, yo, good luck. Right, you want to be like, first of all, you want to give them some guidance, some kind of instructions to follow, and then from there, you know, they're still going to have questions. So here we go with no gimmicks. First of all, second rule is set the learner's role. So what is the role of the learner in the actual play of the escape room? Are they going to be a hero, villain, savior? They got to survive, and just like real life, you have to kind of align to those roles. Right. So you obviously, if you're doing good instructional design, you're going to know who your audience is. And ideally, you want to provide choices, not just make escape room and say, hey, I made escape room, so here you go. Go learn. Some people are going to be like, I don't want to play this stupid thing. Just tell me what the content is. Let me take my quiz. I'm out of here. Right. So respect autonomy, I would say, set that rule. Have a backstory. Right. Rule number 3. So why? Because that's the only way you're going to really get some engagement, some context as to what's happening and what it is. Otherwise, all you have is just straight delivery, right?
And that's the part where you make it relevant to the work to a certain extent, right?
Correct, correct, correct. So in this small example I showed you, it was about, you know, let me see if you guys can prove that you're lifelong learners, huh? You say you're lifelong learners. Well, do you remember this stuff? So that's basically the whole context there. Testing you on that end. Then do the setup. So what I mean by the setup is that since you can't be gimmicky, you can't just say, hey, get into the escape room. You're going to create some kind of excuse or some kind of incident that gets people into the escape room. So by the story, right? By the story, you can start with, this is a situation, you are so-and-so, you are an investigator, you are this, you are an accountant, you're this, whatever. And you need to find this. So there's some kind of clue, right? And then after that, oh, this happened. You need to get away. You're in danger. Something's going to happen. Can you go right? Can you go left? If you make that decision, then that leads into a room. Once you get into the room, then that's where you say, looks like you're trapped. What are we going to do next? Okay, so it's all about decisions. Then give problems, not content, right? So make sure that people are solving a problem. There's some kind of task that needs to be solved. You have to find clues, find those clues, put things together, and then come up to an answer. On six, scaffold, see that? Scaffold. You know what that means in instructional creative design, right? Thanks. You know what that means in instructional design, right? That means you need to start at a certain point. You need to meet people at a certain point and then level up and level up as you need to. So, you know, obviously you wouldn't start with that the way I did it with the first room, but hey, that's what I'm talking about. And use engaging game mechanics. So if you look at game mechanics, there are different ways to engage people, but game mechanics essentially means rules of the game, how to play the game. And how to play the game could be the rules itself. Like, hey, yeah, you're in the escape room. You got to do this. You got to do that. But also that there's achievement, right? Exploration. Those are the things that happen in escape rooms. And survival could be one of those as well. So make sure you check on that. And we have use decoys. That could be a nice one. Once you start getting into leveling up, you can use decoys. So now that's like, I found something. I feel great that I found something. Oh, but this is not related to the thing. Oh, and this could be a way that can set you back or can even make you lose the game and you have to try again. So in e-learning, this will be a better approach, right? Where you lose and you're like, oh, it looks like you made a mistake. Well, I'm not going to touch that picture again, right? I'm not going to touch that picture. You're going back. All right. So nine is start small. So you don't have to have a bunch of rooms. You want to practice this and, you know, get used to it as a designer and coming up with those challenges. And at the end, make sure that you always play test, right? So play test, send it to some people, kind of like what we're doing here, and say, hey, what do you guys feel? What's going on? What's missing? What's there? What's not? So we have some questions in here, right? Yeah.
So J-Rock asked in the question panel, what types of learning objectives fit best with an escape room experience? You know, what kind of content makes sense? What kind of learning experiences? I mean, in some ways, that the shorter version of using it as an introduction could probably introduce just about any kind of a topic if you're using it kind of in that teaser or momentum / introduction kind of a mode.
Yeah, I really think that if you execute well, there's not really anything you really couldn't do. But it's the fact of, again, it's that point of not making it about the escape room, right? So if I'm, you know, I worked in a Fortune 100 enterprises with salespeople making seven figures a year. So time is obviously very, very important for those people, right? So, you know, they're making that kind of money. They don't want to spend time doing courses that are like an hour long or whatever the case. So in that context, that could play out, but it could be delivered in different ways. And the whole point is, I did this for a sales team, right? So in a sales team, what are the things they need to figure out? Well, you're in a house and invited to a client's party, blah, blah, blah. You're in this room and now you're finding clues about rejections and, you know, rebuttals and whatever, how you overcome those things and that type of stuff. So again, it's really, you have to think about what you're trying to do. What is it and how you can then form it to that.
Rachel's dropped an awesome, bit of info in the chat there that her data, because she's done some study work in this, her data found that the escape room fits as part of a solution, but is best supported by multiple activities, you know, pre-work, the game, debrief, etc. It's part of a bigger.
But yeah, like any, I would say, you know, outside of all of this, anything that is gamified cannot be the sole solution. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned before, you don't, you know, you can't just do it as a sole solution. You're not going to have an audience that's going to be all like, yeah, unless you're working for Electronic Arts and everybody's a gamer. And then, you know, your stuff is going to be lame because you're working for Arts. So,
or you're going to be judged for so many levels for the gaminess of like, it. And that's going to be a dissuader. Dude, seriously?
You didn't make this in Unity? What's your problem?
Judgy.
But yeah, no, so that's basically the whole thing about it. And again, for workplace learning, you can look at research, but again, that research is not going to be tying to workplace learning. It's going to be really hard to find something that applies to workplace learning. If you find research that isn't workplace learning, that's still not going to be completely aligned to your organization, because the organizations are always unicorns. So you have to do that analysis yourself, right? Like, what's the environment? Who are your people? And then from there, figure out if this is going to work or not. So that's all I got. Any questions, guys? Oh, okay. And referring to the balance of making it challenging, getting the majority engaged, do you feel if people will be into escape rooms first? That's a cool. Okay, cool.
There's lots of cool stuff. I think lots of great questions that we can continue to talk about and answer in the discussion room and the LinkedIn group we can go back to and check out. And drop in all of your links and any place we can see you, Alexander. You know, super cool having you here and talking about this topic. This is so much fun.
Sure. Thank you so much for having me here, by the way. And again, I usually do this stuff for authoring tools, like working with eLearning, doing eLearning. And you can catch me at eLearning Launch. We're going to do something similar to this, including escape rooms, around October timeframe. So,
yeah. And I've dropped into the chat a couple of times. We have an escape room sample that our team created in Domino One. Not quite as focused in terms of a learning process. It is more of a trivia game kind of a thing.
Yeah.
But lots of fun to check out too. I've dropped a couple of links into the chat there. Brent, did we drop in the LinkedIn group yet?
Not yet. I didn't get a chance to grab that just yet. And I don't think I'm going to get that open in time. If somebody else can drop it in there, that would be fantastic.
I just put it in there. Folks, click on the link. Join us in the LinkedIn and we can follow up some more. And Rachel has provided us with a link to her own research and project as well. So we're going to make sure we include that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Oh my gosh, there's the music ending.
What?
Holy cow, we ran right through the music. Alex, so much. Thanks so much for joining us here. Folks, chat's been great, and we'll catch up with you guys soon. Check us out in the LinkedIn group and watch for the blog post with the follow-up info as well. Thanks, everybody. Have a great rest of your day.
Have a good one.
Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.